How's it going, everyone? Welcome to Straight from the Dome. Welcome to our Wednesday night episode. And as always, joined by Bray. What's up, man?
What's up? We normally try and do this Tuesday, right?
Yeah, that's my bad. I had to study for a final, had a five-week class, a little electronic media law class, and good news is I was up till about 1 a.m. in the library studying last night and pulled off a 90% today, so it was all worth it, and now we're here doing the show, so.
Well, I'm not giving you crap. I'm just, you know, pulling it out.
Yeah, whatever. So a little bye week this week. Not much going on in the land of the Irish until last night when the whole playoff rankings came out. What were your initial reactions? We'll dive into it more here in a second, but I just want to get what your initial reactions when you saw Notre Dame pop off as number 10.
I didn't really get the chance to watch the actual revealing or whatever. I was actually like at a meeting, and I just had my phone in front of me and saw, you know, I just got a couple notifications to my phone from Twitter that, you know, that I have chosen to have, like ESPN, et cetera, Notre Dame football's main account. And, you know, they tweeted out, and my notification came to my phone that we were at number 10, and I was just like, I was just sitting in my chair, and I mean, I was surprised. I mean, I understand we haven't played anybody. Now it looks that way, at least. But I just have a really hard time accepting the fact that what they showed against Florida State and what they've showed earlier in the year, that they're not better than the number 10 team in the country. And I sat in my seat, sank a little bit, and was just like, I just shook my head. Like, that's a tough hill to climb. And, like, at the time, I didn't know who was ahead of us. You know, I figured Michigan State was probably ahead of us. I didn't think TCU or Kansas State would be ahead of us. Maybe more TCU, but less Kansas State. But I just had a hard time, like, grasping it, I guess. Like, I just didn't get it. I don't want to say I felt robbed like I did, like, the Florida State game after that, but, like, I felt underappreciated as a, like, I felt that Notre Dame is a little underappreciated. And, like, I asked you the other day, I said, I mean, I didn't get to watch them, and like they gave somewhat of an explanation of what they're looking for, et cetera. And I believe you said, you know, like they look at head-to-head, strength of schedule, et cetera. And look, I understand the strength of schedule is huge, that Notre Dame hasn't played anybody. And, you know, we can get into what other teams have and haven't done in a little bit. But I guess that was my initial reaction. I mean, what were you thinking? You watched it,
I assume. Yeah, I was watching. Me and my roommate were watching, and he's a big Notre Dame fan too, and honestly, it was kind of weird. I wasn't expecting. I mean, I expected us to be not. I didn't think we'd be in the top five, quite honestly. I didn't. I thought maybe six, seven, maybe eight. So when I saw 10, I was just kind of like, it was kind of like a disappointment, like you said. And then I thought about it, and I thought about it more, and I'm just reading all through all the Twitters, and everyone's going off about it, and just going crazy and freaking out like it's the end of the world. This is the worst thing that ever happened in Notre Dame football, and I'm just thinking, man, you know what? I looked at our schedule, and then I looked at everything, and I just kept looking at it, and I understood a little more why we're number 10. I still think we should be ahead of some people, but we'll dive into that here in a second. But yeah, this reaction, obviously, disappointment, and I think a lot of Notre Dame fans were, but unfortunately, some Notre Dame fans on Twitter were freaking out so much that it just got to the point where I was like, shut up, you know, just stop.
Like you said, it's early. I mean, it's an early poll, and this poll really means nothing, but it kind of does, because if you start at 10 or you start, if you have a huge hill to climb like Notre Dame has now, that just makes it way more difficult than somebody who maybe like Michigan State, who's probably not worthy of an eighth ranking. They have a little easier hill to climb with an easier schedule down the stretch. So, you know what I'm saying there?
Yeah, you're absolutely correct. I mean, this poll is very early, like you said, but it is what the college football playoff thinks of us right now, and that's the people we're trying to impress. So, I mean, there's obviously a lot of room to for improvement. There's, you know, we have probably the best teams on our schedule are coming up with Arizona State and Louisville. So I mean, there's room to go up. There's a lot of losing for these SEC West teams to do, but there's also a lot of winning if you want to put it that way too. So
Yeah, definitely. You just said it. They're going to beat up on themselves, but you just hit it even better, is that one or two of those teams is going to look really good after they beat each other up.
Right. Right. So, yeah. So I guess let's dive into it in depth here. Here's the top 10. We'll go top 10. Mississippi State at 7-0, number one. Florida State 7-0, number two. Those are your two undefeated teams in the nation right now, except for Marshall, but Marshall is irrelevant. Then we go Auburn, Mississippi, or Auburn, Ole Miss, and Oregon at 3-4-5. Alabama, TCU, Michigan State at 6-7-8. Kansas State, and then Notre Dame rounding off the top 10. And Georgia at number 11 also has a legitimate chance as well. I'd say those are your 11 teams that probably have a chance. There might be a couple teams down at the bottom, maybe an Ohio State if they were to get very lucky the rest of the season. I don't see any other teams beyond that even having a chance. So, obviously, Mississippi State and Florida State, you can't argue those. They're the two undefeated teams. They're the two teams that are at the top. A little surprising, though, with the Auburn, Ole Miss 3-4 instead of Alabama. Any thoughts on that?
Here's one little statistic that somebody that we had on the show, one of our second or third show ever, his name is Chad Springer on Twitter. He brought this to my attention, and I hadn't really thought about it. It's a team is ranked higher than Notre Dame that has got beaten by three touchdowns, and that team is Auburn. They lost to Mississippi State 38-23, and that was on October 11th. What is that, 2 weeks ago, three weeks ago? And it's like that's semi-fresh in people's minds, and they're still ranked number three.
Yeah, and it's surprising. That's really surprising. They're surprising that they're over Ole Miss in that case because, I mean, Ole Miss did lose last week, but they lost on the road at Happy Valley by three and didn't play very well. So surprised that Auburn is in front of them, and even Alabama is kind of surprised that Alabama did sneak into the top four. But I think the playoff committee said head-to-head is going to mean a lot, and so that's why Ole Miss is in front of Alabama right now. So
I don't know. If you look at it like this, when Oregon and Michigan State played, and Oregon is ranked five, I don't really have a problem with that. They lost to Arizona, who on this is ranked number 12.
Yep.
But they lost to them at home. Probably shouldn't have. You would take Oregon 9 times out of 10 in that matchup. And you know, upsets can happen. That's fine. But you look at this. Oregon is 5. Michigan State is 8. You watch that game, and look, Michigan State was competitive in that game for half the game. I mean, that's what they were. They were competitive in that game for half the game. Second half, they got absolutely dominated. You could tell that they were the less superior team of the two. I just don't get how they can only be 3 spots apart. Oregon looked like a better football team when they beat them earlier in the year than only 3 spot difference.
Yeah, it is surprising that Michigan State's where they're at. Notre Dame's problem right now is we haven't really played anybody in the top 25. You can make the argument, and you've kind of made it, well, Stanford's not in the top 25 because of us. All right, argument taken. But if it hadn't been for that, Stanford's going to barely be on the top 25. So that's your closest team we have right now to the top 25 that we've beaten. Michigan State's beaten Nebraska, who is number 15. That's probably why they are ahead of us, but because we absolutely have the better loss in that situation. I think on the road at Florida State, losing the way we did is a little better than losing to Oregon. Excuse me, by the way that Michigan State did. I understand it was on the road in like week two, but still.
Okay, so I want to compare schedules between Michigan State and Notre Dame. Okay. Look, I understand that Michigan State beat Nebraska, who at the time, what were they ranked? They were ranked 19th at the time. Okay, their only quality opponent on their schedule so far, other than Oregon, and they lost that game. Okay, so they have no. You look at Michigan State. Okay, this is who they've played: Jacksonville State, Oregon, which we've already discussed that. Eastern Michigan, Wyoming, Nebraska, Purdue, Indiana, Michigan. Okay? That is abysmal. That is terrible. Jacksonville State, Eastern Michigan, Wyoming. And I understand that they handled those teams, and that is fine. You can give me that argument. But when they beat Nebraska, it was at home, and they were ranked number 19 at the time. Okay? Notre Dame's wins are against opponents such as Rice, an equivalent opponent in Michigan, Purdue, Syracuse. And they beat Stanford at home. At the time, Stanford was ranked 14th.
Mm-hmm.
To me, that looks miles ahead better. I mean, there's no Wyoming. There's no Jacksonville State. There's no Eastern Michigan. To me, that is just miles ahead better, and I just don't understand, like, what they saw. Like, look, they beat Nebraska, the only reason that Nebraska is ranked where they are right now is because they also haven't played anybody all year to have beaten them other than Michigan State. Nebraska has not beaten a quality opponent all year. They barely beat McKenzie State at home on the last second. Notre Dame beat Stanford, who plays a much tougher schedule than Nebraska, which is why Stanford is in the position that they are right now.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I'm not arguing that Michigan State should be in front of us. I'm just stating why I think the college football playoff put them there.
Yes.
It's hard to go into this committee's brains and see what they want and what they're doing. It's such a random group of people. I mean, Connelly's a Rice and Tyrone Willingham, who was coaching Stanford women's golf at one point. So, I mean, you got some – and Pat – I mean, you got some – I don't want to be this person, but there might be some anti-Notre Dame bias in that room. And I'm sure, yeah, they'll just say, well, there's no biases, we're professionals, blah, blah, blah. But there might be a little anti-Notre Dame bias in that room, especially with us being independent, not playing in a conference. I think that hurts us a little.
Yeah, do you think Pat Hayden might have a little bit of anti-Notre Dame in him? All Notre Dame games on NBC.
He has a lot of anti-Notre Dame in him. Tyrone Willingham was fired by the university.
Correct.
Was pretty much ousted by the community. Yeah.
And look, we're not making accusations.
No, not at all. I'm just spitballing why. Because, I mean, just based on stats and schedules and all that, it doesn't make sense that some of these teams are in front of us.
I guess a question that I have, and I don't know if this has been explained. I don't know if I've missed it. It very well may be the case. How do they determine their rankings? I mean, there's 12 of them now. There were 13. Mm-hmm. What process do they go through to, like, do they each rank maybe a top 15 or a top 25, and then do they take the average of their rankings of each team? Like, what do they do that can put 12 minds together to determine that?
You know, I'm looking at the press release that they put out with the rankings and everything else. I don't know if they're going to have anything on it. I'm kind of searching really fast. College football players went for the last few days and sent us likes and judgment. We debated, we reviewed facts and statistics, and we used our judgment.
Okay, so that's fine. They use their judgment. That's what we expect.
Yeah.
But what? Okay, so how do they categorize their judgment into ranking? There's 12 people.
I really don't know. It doesn't really say.
Because you and I can sit here and argue about who is where, and we're going to have different opinions on where people are and where they should be ranked. So if that's going to happen between you and I can only imagine what 12 different people think. So my question then is, what do they do to come to a consensus of where teams are supposed to be?
I don't know. I wish I had an answer. I don't know. That would be something. I don't know if you could find it on the internet or not, or if they're keeping it secret. You know what I'm saying? So.
Yeah, and I'm not asking you to give me an answer. I'm just proposing the question and to try and bring up a point, I guess.
Right. No, I would imagine it's got to be hard to sit in that room and come up with the top. I'm sure the top bottom 15 is not that hard, but the top 10's got to be hard to come up with, and I don't know how they do it and what exactly they're looking for. I know they're looking for strength of schedule, head-to-heads, record, and performance in games. So you take our strength of schedule is not that great, I don't think, right now.
Correct.
But if you look at our head-to-heads and you look at our performance in games, with the one game we lost, if you look at that performance, I don't see how we're number 10.
So. Yeah, and you can pull up on ESPN. It's under the playoff picture. Okay, and they give resume ranks, football power index, etc. Okay, and Notre Dame has a is ranked currently that has a 23rd toughest strength of schedule. Okay, that's higher than 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 teams in front of them.
Okay.
Okay. They are ranked in what is this category? Strength of record. They have the 12th best strength of record. That is better than one. That is better than two teams ranked ahead of them.
Okay.
What is this? Game control. They are ranked 15th. That is better than 1, 2 teams in front of them. Okay. So, look, I don't know if that's what they look at, a bunch of numbers like this, or what, but still, through those, there's an average of being better than at least two teams in front of them in each of those categories. So I guess that kind of it would make sense for Notre Dame to be ranked a little bit higher than 10 to me, if that's what they're looking at.
Mm-hmm. No, I absolutely agree. I think we can both sit here and we can both agree that we don't agree with where we're at, but I'm also going to say, at the most, I would put us at 7, maybe 6 or 8, I honestly think. So
I expected 6 or 7. Mm-hmm. And look, if you're 6 or 7 right now, which who's at 6 right now? I just
Alabama.
Okay, so if you're Alabama or TCU, you're in a really, really good spot to take care of business and get in. If you're at 10 like Notre Dame, you're in a spot where you could win out and not get in.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's really that simple, and there's no panic or whatever you want to call it. It's just facts. The people ahead of Notre Dame in the winner of the TCU-Kansas game, Kansas State game, because they play, Michigan State and Oregon, okay? Like we said, there's probably two spots already secured. If Florida State wins tomorrow night, they're not losing the rest of the year. They're in, okay? Then the winner of the SEC West is more than likely, I mean, there's no way you can hold that team out of the playoff.
Yeah.
So there's two spots right there. That means there's two spots left for Oregon, the winner of TCU, Kansas State, Michigan State, and Notre Dame. And them being ahead of Notre Dame right now in this first ranking would make it really hard for Notre Dame to jump those teams. If Michigan State wins out and controls every game without a doubt by 10-plus points, same thing for Oregon and the winner of the TCU, Kansas State game. It is going to be really, really hard for Notre Dame to jump those teams because they didn't do anything that would say that they're a bad team.
Right. So let me ask you this, and this is kind of moving on in our show just a tad. I'm going to ask a question to you. What needs to happen for Notre Dame to make the playoff with Notre Dame and some of the other teams? And good luck deciphering it.
Look, there's a million things that can happen. And
what's the most, let me ask you, what's the most possible thing? How about that? That's a better way to say it.
You know, I think Stanford could beat Oregon because, you know, years past Stanford has had Oregon's number. I mean, that's clear. Nobody can deny that. So the reasoning behind saying that Stanford can beat Oregon is there. And Oregon has showed that they're very beatable, and they look great at times, but like we just said, they're very, very beatable. I think TCU needs to beat Kansas State because TCU has the tougher schedule down the stretch. Because once TCU beats Kansas State, if that were to happen, they would still have to play – come on, load. They would still have to play – they still play West Virginia and Texas. Okay. Well, I understand Texas is not that good, but they have a little better shot of losing after. Okay. And if Kansas State were to win that game, they play. Oh, I'm sorry. I have them confused. I'm sorry. Kansas State needs to beat TCU because Kansas State's schedule down the stretch is tougher. They play after the TCU game, they play at West Virginia and at Baylor, which are two top 20 teams right now. So I think if Kansas State can beat TCU, they have a better chance of getting that second loss, and that sort of eliminates both teams, okay? And like we said, we need Stanford to beat Oregon, which is very possible, and they play this weekend.
Mm.
And if those two things happen, and let's say Ohio State beats Michigan State, then I think Michigan State, Ohio State kind of swap spots. So it's going to be Notre Dame against Ohio State. But at that point, it's like Notre Dame has the better loss. And Notre Dame has a better loss out of all these teams right now. But the Mississippi State, Auburn, Ole Miss, Alabama are going to beat each other up a little bit. And there's going to be one team probably out of that, maybe two, that can make a pretty solid case to be in. Mm-hmm. And I think the winner of that has to be in. There's no way you can hold that winner out. But like we said, if Stanford beats Oregon this weekend, that will be a huge, huge start. And if the right team out of TCU and Kansas State wins, then that'll be even better. And look, that'll help. That'll take care. We will probably be able to win out and get in. But that's a lot of things that need to happen, and in a certain order that they need to happen.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, that's kind of the point in it.
Yeah, and it sucks. It really sucks. But my message to Notre Dame Nation and Irish fans everywhere, relax. Take a deep breath. You know, I said it on Twitter last night. I was getting a little annoyed. Excuse me. Sorry. I've got a bug, man, and it's bothering me. I said this last night on Twitter. It's almost getting to the point where it's annoying with all the crying and, oh, everyone's out to get us. No, not everyone's out to get us. Look, right now we still have to win against two top 25 good football teams and two or three teams that aren't very bad football teams. So we still have to win out. If we win out and we don't get in, then I will be mad. But at the same time, I don't think we can be that mad if we don't get in. We have to understand. So my message is just relax. Let the season play out for a couple weeks. Let a couple more polls come out. If we start slipping in the rankings, then let's start marching to the College Football Playoff Committee and protest. But until then, simmer down and let's move on to Navy, which we're going to do right now. So
yeah, I mean, as long as we win, we're fine, and we're positioning ourselves to be in a really good spot. And then that allows us to kind of get a feel of what the College Football Committee is looking for.
Right.
And rankings are going to change each week, you know, depending on their strength of schedule and head-to-head matches, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, like you said, I'm not panicking. I just think it's a really, really tall hill to climb from 10. And with the favorable schedules of the teams ahead of us that need to lose, I think it's just hard. The right team has to lose, and it has to be at the right time. And there's just a lot of things that have to go, you know, to kind of make it happen.
Right. And if you think about it, in 2012, we weren't necessarily in the same boat because we were undefeated, but the same thing kind of happened, though. We had to have some teams lose, and those teams did lose, which propelled us to where we got.
Yeah.
So, and I think at this point in that year, we were either 4 or 3 right now, so just everybody relax, put on the brake, and let's focus on Navy. So, well, let's do that. Let's move on to Navy real fast, or not real fast, but move on to Navy now. Irish are going on the road, kind of, technically. I mean, it's neutral site. Playing at FedEx Field in Washington, D.C., taking on the Midshipmen, storied rival. The Navy never plays us. They always play us tough. That's the best way to put it. Navy comes in at 4-4, not ranked. However, they have the second best rushing attack in the nation, averaging about 352.3 yards a game. That's a lot of rushing yards. And they could score the ball. They're averaging about 30.9 points a game, and their defense isn't horrible, giving about 27.6 a game. So that's just 76 overall, and they're 58th overall for points scored. So, I mean, Navy's no cupcake team, but I do think the key for the Irish has to be you got to stop the rushing attack first off. And if we can do that, this game's going to be pretty favorable towards Notre Dame. But any thoughts on that?
I think some of their defensive statistics are somewhat skewed, because they really haven't played that great a competition. And it says that they're giving up 27.6 points per game, but you look at it, they gave up 34 to Ohio State, 24 to Temple, 21 to Rutgers, 21 to Texas State, 31 to Rutgers, 36 to West Kentucky, and 30 against Air Force. When they lose games, they're giving up over 30 points a game.
Mm-hmm.
And as we've seen, Notre Dame is very capable of doing that. And I think Notre Dame is going to be fine offensively. But for some reason, like you said, the scheme that they throw at us, we're just not really built to beat a team like that. And it's a tough offense to prepare for. It's not something like you're not used to seeing this. Like, we're used to seeing this red offense every week right now. We're not used to seeing a triple option team that, and Keenan Reynolds, their quarterback, is very, very good. He's been there for what feels like forever. He feels like Denard Robinson, man. He was at Michigan for 10 years, it felt like. Keenan Reynolds feels the same way. He leads a team in rushing. He leads a team in passing. Second time we played a quarterback like that this year. The quarterback from North Carolina being the other. Like you said, clearly the way you beat Navy is stop the run, because that's all they do. Reynolds has only thrown the ball 69 times this year. That's not how they're going to beat you. Even in like big scenarios when they're maybe running the two-minute drill, they're still running the triple option. And that's how they're going to march down the field on you. And for some reason, we've had trouble in the past. I think you just had to attribute to it that that's not the way we're built. We're a little quicker. We're not really built to plug up huge holes and be cut blocked the entire game. And I think we'll be fine, but it's just one of those games where it's like, it's an important game to dominate, especially after the recent college football playoff ranking has come out. It's an important week and game to dominate and to show exactly what Notre Dame is. And I think it's only going to hurt us if we don't beat them by 17 or 20 very handily. And they could score in garbage time, I guess, and make it come down, because the game will be a lot better. The game will be more worse. What the heck? The game will look worse than what it was. So, I don't know. There's a ton to go into it. You need to stop the run. I mean, that's how you beat Navy. I mean, that's the bottom line. They're not going to beat you through the air, like you just said. It's interesting, though, because we have to come out and dominate the game. And you talked about that earlier, and you can elaborate a little bit more, but that's the key. We have to win by 30.
No, yeah, you got it. I mean, I have it written down in the order of the show. The last thing we were going to talk about was importance of dominating them. But we'll bump it up right now. Yeah, we absolutely have to come out and just beat them by 30 or more points. There's no coming out like a Purdue or a Syracuse or even a North Carolina where we come out slow and play like, you know, crap for a half or a quarter. We have to come out and score on every drive, or at least try. I understand we do, but I mean, we have to be aggressive. It has to be another Florida State offensive attack.
Yep.
The
biggest thing that when you look at it is they're going to run the ball. That's clear. But their main objective is to hold the ball as long as they possibly can and dominate you in time of possession.
Exactly.
Now, I don't care if they dominate us in time of possession if we're, you know, moving the ball well, having really quick minute, 30-second drives and scoring touchdowns. That doesn't bother me.
Right.
But if they're controlling the time of possession and we're not scoring, it's going to be terrible. It's going to kill us.
Their best defense is their offense for us. That they are going to try and take 10 minutes off the board every time they have the ball. We need to try and score in 2 minutes or less. We need to be the Brian Kelly of Cincinnati. That's what we need to do. And I'm going to be disappointed, honestly, if we don't win by 25 or more points, 21 or more points, you know, somewhere in that area. Because it is all about perception now. It is how we go out and play these teams. There's nothing we can do about our schedule now. There's nothing we can do about Florida State. There's nothing we can do about these other teams at play. We have to go out and take care of our business. And if we can't do that, then we don't deserve to be in the playoff. So it's hard. It's a tough road. But this is the first step. And hopefully Brian Kelly has these guys kind of pissed off, and they come out and prove that, hey, we're not the 10th ranked team in this nation. We are number 5, number 4, number 6. We should be up there. We deserve to be up there. We got screwed against one of the best teams in the nation. We should have won that game. So now we're going to take it out on these little Navy midshipmen. So
Yeah, and if they weren't fired up before, I mean, I don't know how they can't be now.
Right.
And I hope they take it personal. I mean, I'm going to be 100% honest. There were a lot of non-Notre Dame fans that have agreed with me and have similar opinions. There's a lot of ESPN analysts who have historically in the past not exactly been on Notre Dame's side. Mm-hmm. Kirk has been a solid he's a guy that doesn't give Notre Dame a lot of credit. And Colin Cowherd is another example, doesn't ever really give Notre Dame a ton of credit. But when they do something that they deserve credit, those guys will give you credit. And you could tell that Kirk was a little bit surprised listening to Colin. He's a little bit he was kind of surprised at number 10. And I saw an interview with Bob Stoops had on his, like, he kind of has a Brian Kelly radio show, except it's Bob Stoops' radio show at Oklahoma. And their host asked Bob Stoops what his biggest surprise was, and he said more than once it was Notre Dame at 10. He couldn't believe Notre Dame was at 10. And I agree. This is almost his exact words. I'm paraphrasing, but in essence, he said they went to Florida State on the road, played the defending national champions against the defending Heisman Trophy winner, lost by a play at the very end of the game where they very well could have won. It was taken away from them on the last play of the game, whether it's the right call or not. They had scored. They had won the game. It was taken away, and they proved that they were better than the number 10 team in the country. They showed last week that they dominated Florida State. I mean, that's clear. They did. And what they showed last weekend against Florida State, it shows more than the 10th best team in the college football playoff committee rankings to me.
And it might have hurt us a little bit, honestly. I didn't think about this till now. We were on bye week, so maybe that hurt us a little bit too. Yeah, because we didn't get to show. We haven't got to show our post that happening. So you know what I'm saying? With what happened at Florida State, we haven't gotten to go and show that what happened at Florida State wasn't a fluke. You know, this wasn't us just, you know, playing out of our minds. That was us playing. So I think that hurt us a little bit too. But
yeah, and you would hope that the bye week really wouldn't hurt you, but, I mean, let's be honest, it couldn't have come at a worse time, because the last glimpse that they had is us losing to Florida State. If we would have played Navy last week and won by 30, that would have been the last thing in their head.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you know, as much as we don't want that to affect us, I think it might have a little bit.
Right. Yeah, you're absolutely correct. So let's move it on here. What are some keys for the Irish this week as we go and take on the Midshipmen to get a favorable W?
What are the keys?
Yeah, what are the keys for the Irish?
Obviously stopping the run. I mean, that's the number one thing, like we said, to beating Navy, you have to stop the run. We need to make sure that we score quickly, because they're going to try and hold the ball the entire game. They want to win the time of possession by 20 minutes if possible. That's going to be huge. We need to be consistent on offense. We need to be sharp. There isn't any lackadaisical play that can happen, because as we're going to hit on, the way that Notre Dame needs to win these games down the stretch, they need to make a point. They need to make a point that they're beating teams like Arizona State on the road handily, USC on the road handily. They need to beat ranked teams like Louisville handily. They need to beat teams like Northwestern and Navy, who aren't ranked and not very good, very handily. They need to be in control of every game, because them winning out just isn't enough at this point. They have to make a statement. They have to make a point. They have to make it very well known, and they have to make it impossible for the College Football Playoff Committee to keep them out at where they are right now.
No, I would agree. My key is, as first and foremost, stop the rushing attack, stop the triple option, whatever you want to call it. Second is take care of the football, not because of I don't think we will win if we don't take care of the football, but it's the perception, once again, like we talked about. And also, score the freaking football. That's my third key. So I honestly think there's not a worry that we're going to get beat. I just don't see us getting beat. It's just more of how we're going to win, how we win, or how bad of a game we could play, or how good of a game we could play. So
yeah, we have to look good. I mean, yeah. We can't. If we beat, I can tell you right now, if we beat Navy by 10 and the whole game it looks like a 10-point game,
well, we have no chance.
No chance. We're done. This game, it's make or break.
Yeah. So, and then that's how every game's going to be from now on. I mean, we're going to have to dominate Navy. We're going to have to win pretty favorably against Arizona State, even though we're on the road at Arizona State, who's a top 25 team. It's all about perception once again. We're going to have to dominate Louisville. We're going to have to dominate Northwestern, and we're going to have to dominate USC because, you know, in the college playoff committee's eyes, those teams aren't that good.
Yeah, and they gave us the benefit of the doubt. They made a point. They said, look, Notre Dame plays some interesting games and tough games coming up, and we'll take another look at them as that happens.
Right.
That's completely fair. That's completely fair, and that is Notre Dame's opportunity to make that statement to that committee. Mm-hmm. And that's just something that we need to look forward to, something that we need to depend on. We have to depend on beating Navy handily and taking care of these games without any sort of doubt moving down the stretch.
Absolutely. So, looking at the schedule here, looks like we're on Pick'em. Will you want to play a little Pick'em?
Yeah, absolutely.
After that butt whooping last week I put on you.
Whatever. What was it? What was it?
Well, let's just say you were 6-4. I was 9-1. That's.
I made a couple ballsy picks.
You did make a couple ballsy picks.
We were picking the same for the first like six games, and I was like, well, one of us has to pick differently, and you know.
Yeah, sure.
I picked Tennessee to beat Alabama.
Yeah, you did. Yes.
Yeah, and I picked your Ball State to lose. We always pick Augie
Tennessee. This did not happen.
Right, because whatever, he's a Ball State trip.
Ball State. Guy, whatever. Fight team, fight for Ball State. We are on a winning streak. And on our bye week, we're looking good.
What's your winning streak?
We are on two-winning streak. That brings us to 3-6, maybe. We're on bye week right now, or we're 3-5, I think.
So you're on it. You're riding some momentum.
Yeah, we're on a bye week right now. We got Northern coming into town next Wednesday. It's going to be a primetime game, ESPN2.
Yeah. Riding a two-game win streak into a bye week.
I'm going to be out. I'm gonna try and be in the crowd promoting the show. I'm going to make a sign that says, we want Bama. We want Mississippi State.
Yeah.
We're on our way. BCS can become.
So. You're going to represent as well.
Yes, yes. I will. I will promise that. If I'm not in the library for another 4 hours again. So.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let's play here. First game, Thursday night game, tomorrow night, prime time, ACC, the old Seminoles and Jameis. I saw a tweet today. They stopped at Joe's Crab Shack after practice. I thought that was a little comical.
That is comical. Actually, I don't think they ate there. I think they just walked by it. But still, that's the point.
Same thing. The picture was captured.
Why put yourself in that position if you're that? You know, it's just like, they're just asking for
their it. Their PR person was not on point that day.
Correct.
Number 2 Florida State heads to Louisville to Papa John's Stadium. ACC matchup, number 25 team in the nation. Who you got?
I love Papa John's.
Hey, they're coming out with a new chili cheese pizza.
Yeah, I saw that today.
Like a walking taco on pizza. Oh, I can't wait, man. Oh, it's going to be good.
I saw that stupid. It looks kind of gross, to be honest.
Oh, it looks fantastic.
It has Fritos on the pizza.
It's a walking taco on pizza, man. It's phenomenal.
I mean, I'll give it a shot, but it just doesn't. It's not tickling my fancy right now.
It's tickling my fancy.
Clearly. If you are listening to our podcast on Podbean, you can also watch us on our YouTube channel. That's kind of what we use to record. It's an interactive thing that we don't promote as much, but you can look at Augie's face talking about walking taco pizza right now. It's priceless.
Yeah, it's oh, I can't wait. All right, who you got?
Okay, I mean, I'm picking Florida State because they have to win out.
Yeah, I got Florida State as well. Unfortunately, Jameis is too good, I think. And Louisville does have the best defense in the nation, but I don't think they're up to the task. Plus Florida State coming off a bye after that. Although, of course, they're on another a sexual assault, and somehow, phenomenally, the girl is dropping the charges once again.
How convenient.
Great. I don't know, right? Must be nice.
Look, did you see anything on Twitter the other day that I had going with that?
You know, no, I didn't. I tried to stay out of your Twitter rants or arguments.
It was a blast. I was just going after these Florida State fans, and I'm just going to share one thing because it's disgusting to me, but I want to share what the level that, first of all, as anybody has noticed, the level that that institution, and by institution I mean Florida State, okay, has an institution, has gone, whether it be academic side, whether it be at the athletic department, down to the football coach, football program in general, the lengths that they have gone to sort of defend and try and justify what has been going on in that program, whether it be Jameis Winston stealing crab legs, Jameis Winston having BB gun incidents on campus, Jameis Winston sexually assaulting a woman and potentially been covered up by the university, whatever it may be. And now when you add this Carlos Williams, I believe is what his name is, their running back, who's their leading rusher, domestic violence of some sort, his baby mama, okay? So this is what happened. I read about it, okay, on Twitter. She posted a couple pictures on Facebook of her and her bruises on herself, and she pretty much said, I'm coming out and speaking out against domestic violence because I'm a victim and I'm tired of it and blah, 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 okay? So that came out. It's the victim's Facebook, and the Tallahassee Police Department was involved at that point. And Jimbo Fisher was asked about it, and they said that whoever said that his girlfriend had posted pictures, and he's like, that's not a good enough source. It's a bunch of crap. It's like, you do realize the limb you're going out on by defending that guy, right? You're pretty much defending domestic violence. And it's like, you're trying to justify what he did so that he can give you 150 yards rushing this weekend against Louisville. Mm-hmm. It's just sickening to me, and I can't believe it. And I got into it with some Florida State fans, like I said. Somebody on my timeline that I follow, or however it worked out, this chick, this Misty, her name is @KnowlesMisty, okay? Go give her hell, because she's a fraud. Somehow she showed up on my timeline, and I saw one of her tweets, which then inspired me to see if she had said anything else up to that point. I saw one tweet that said, and this is her exact tweet, am I missing something, or did she have marks anywhere other than her arms? Okay, so I read that, and I knew exactly what it was about to start, and that had me interested enough to look at her profile. First of all, in that statement, am I missing something, or did she have marks anywhere other than her arms? Is that not, like, point number one to you, like, whoa, I mean, it doesn't matter where her marks are, does it? I mean, what is this chick trying to say? I mean, to you, if you read that after seeing that and hearing that, I mean, what goes through your mind?
Right. No, it's the thing about it, like, don't you think Jimbo used to be a pretty respected guy between the media and fans, but I think his reputation just the last year has just gone down the drain, and I feel sorry for the guy, but recruit some better players.
Yeah, he's not picking guys that are representing him and his ways very well.
No.
So she says that. Okay, so that has me interested. I look at her timeline, and then her next tweet is this. Isn't a guy supposed to grab a girl and hold her down when she's hitting him in the face rather than hit her back? Okay. That face you just made is exactly what I did. I'm like, what? Yeah. Okay. So, look, if my fiance is beating the crap out of me in not a fun way, like we're not messing around, like playfully fighting, however, whatever you want to call it, you know, I'm you know, yeah, of course, like we're just messing around. But if she's physically assaulting me because I've hit her or whatever the reason may be, it doesn't even matter. I'm never putting my hands on her. And yes, I will probably, you know, do my best to like maybe separate myself. But if you see these bruises on this chick's arm, it's not just pushing her out of the way and holding her there like, please don't hit me. It's like he's making a point to squeeze rather hardly, to do whatever he's doing, and he's restraining her in a way that is over the top, clearly, because that just does not, you don't bruise like that from just trying to restrain her and trying to, a calm way, I guess. And look, if she's hitting you, you're a grown man on a football team. You're one of the best athletes in the country. You can move and remove yourself from the room. You don't have to physically put your hands on her and squeeze her arms to make her stop hitting you.
Yeah.
So right there. Sorry, her next tweet. Because that's exactly what it looks like happened based on these photos. So let me get this straight. First of all, she's asking a question. If she doesn't have any marks on anywhere on her body other than her arms, okay? And then she says, isn't a guy supposed to grab you if she's hitting you? And then she's saying, because that's what it looks like to me in these pictures. You are justifying what this guy did to that female. You are justifying domestic violence so that your running back can get you 150 yards this weekend because that W is more important. And this is coming from a female. This is not coming from a male. And that I just cannot believe what I read right there. It's just sickening to me.
Almost makes you glad to be in the situation we're in with the team and university we respect and cheer for rather than some of these other universities. It's sickening. It really is.
Look, I didn't mean to get on a huge rant there, but I wanted to share that with people. Because I mean, you can find it on my Twitter, it's in my pictures. It's at BrayBeals34. I don't know if all of you had seen them yet, but a lot of people had because a lot of people were chiming in on it. I just can't believe that the level that these fans are going to defend that these football players that are just continuously making a bad name for that university.
Yeah. So, all right, well, let's move on to our next game. I promise everybody Bray will not have a rant for every game we talk about.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Unless you got in a Twitter argument with some other people that I don't know about. Well, let's move on to the Big 12 here. Number 7, TCU, going on the road to West Virginia, who's number 20. Who you got?
You know, we need TCU to lose, so I'm going West Virginia.
That's who I picked as well. I got West Virginia. I think West Virginia is on a little roll. Not a bad football team either, and they got them at home, so I think that place is going to be popping.
Yeah.
Old Morgantown's going to be a little intoxicated after tailgate, and they're gonna be ready to go. So
yeah, absolutely.
So we'll go to the West Coast here. Stanford goes on the road at number 5, Oregon.
I gotta stop picking these teams because we need them to lose. I think Oregon's a better team. It's not that I don't think Stanford could beat them. I just think Oregon's too good of a team.
I have Oregon as well. I would love to be wrong, though. Trust me, yep. I would love for that one to be wrong. Staying in the Pac-12, number 12 Arizona at the road, on the road, at number 22 UCLA.
You know, I think UCLA is really overrated, and we've seen that this year in the games that they've played. They just haven't looked as good as, you know, everyone's kind of hopes going into the year. They had a lot of hype. I think Arizona is like a really sneaky kind of tough team. I'm not really rooting for them, but I think that they're really interesting to watch. And so I'm going to take Arizona.
I'm going to disagree with you on this one. Old Rich Rod, I think he's going to walk home in shame. I think UCLA takes it at home. I think they'll be ready to go, ready to prove something.
Yep.
Number 17, Utah at... That's not right. Oh, is it? Yeah, Utah-Arizona State. Is that right? Yeah.
Is it?
I don't know. That doesn't sound right, does it?
I don't know. It might. Yeah, Arizona State.
I knew I wrote it down right. Number 17, Utah at number 14, Arizona State.
We need Arizona State to win that game so that they're going to be ranked as high as possible for when Notre Dame plays them and hopefully beats them. So, and plus, I do think Arizona State's a better team. I think Utah's very scary as well. I mean, you saw what they did to Michigan in the Big House. They beat USC last weekend, who's full of athletes. Mm-hmm. I think Utah's a very scary team, and I wouldn't want to play Utah. I can tell you that.
No, I wouldn't either, but I do think Arizona State pulls it off at home a week before we head over there and play them. SEC battle. Florida goes on the – or I don't know if they're on the road or not, but they take on number 11, Georgia.
You know, Georgia's – for some reason, they're really rolling right now, and I thought losing Todd Gurley, they'd take a little bit of a step back. But they've kind of handled some teams since he's been gone. And, you know, the news came out today that he's back November 15th, I believe. Yeah,
3 games he's going to be out for.
Right. So, you know, I think they're rolling. They're hot. I don't think – and Florida is just a hot mess down there. Holy cow. They can't score a point against Missouri. It's just Will Muschamp, his days are numbered down there. Yes. I can't see Florida pulling that out.
I would have to agree with you there. I got Georgia as well. I don't see Florida pulling off a miraculous upset. Going to the Big Ten, the Sad Ten, It's just a sad conference right now. Two good teams there. Or three, I guess you could say. Indiana at the Big House.
Oh, man. How awesome would that be if IU beat them?
That's who I'm picking, man. I got to stick with my Hoosiers. They always play them tough. I could see this being the year.
I'm going to pick Michigan only because my boss at work and I did a FanDuel college football thing. We went halvesies on it. And we ended up picking Devin Funchess, hopefully to go off against that IU defense, which isn't very good. So in only hopes of me winning, I don't know, a couple thousand dollars on FanDuel, that Devin Funchess has three touchdowns, and that would probably mean Michigan wins.
Yeah, I'm going to disagree. Not that I don't want you to win the money, but yeah. I would love to watch Michigan lose, and you got to root for the Hoosiers.
Yeah, my reasoning isn't picking a better team here. My reasoning is trying to win a couple thousand dollars.
All right. Texas at Texas Tech. Interesting matchup here.
Yeah, really interesting. It's a rivalry, pretty big rivalry. I mean, it's like the Oklahoma game with Texas, the Red River rivalry. Mm. It really doesn't matter what your record is. And that showed this year Oklahoma's a better football team, but it was a relatively close game. I'm rooting for Charlie Strong. I'm rooting for him to turn that around there, and he's trying to establish a culture that represents him and his mission moving forward, and I'm rooting for that to succeed because I think Charlie Strong is a good guy, and I think Texas is starting to move in the right direction with who they have there, and I'm gonna root for Texas here.
Yep, I got Texas as well. I agree with you 100% on Charlie Strong. Great guy. Was at Louisville. I've always kind of liked Louisville and what he did there. So,
ex-Notre Dame guy.
Yeah, that too. So, then we're going to move on to the SEC, probably the game of the week, the biggest game, I'd say, all year probably, with the exception of maybe Notre Dame, Florida State, but I'd say this is even a bigger game. Number 3, Auburn at number 4, Ole Miss.
See, I'm kind of curious to hear your thoughts on this. Does it matter really who loses this game?
Whoever loses this game is going to 2 losses.
Right.
Knocking you out. That's your biggest thing. And that'd be a long road to climb. This would be the first team to kind of say, all right, they're done. Not that I don't think it's impossible for a 2-loss SEC team, but I think there's going to be too many 1-loss teams and undefeated teams to get in. So.
Okay, so I guess what I'm asking you is, let's say Ole Miss loses, and then they play Mississippi State the last game of the year, who's number 1.
Mm-hmm.
If they beat them then, is that enough to give them any sort of shot?
I would say it all depends on what other teams have done. Right. So, I mean, Auburn would probably be up there because if they beat Ole Miss, you know, they're going to be up there. Florida State will be up there. There's 2 teams. Alabama would have the chance to be up there.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's so, like we said before, it's so early. Like, there's a good 3 weeks before we can sit here and say, this is probably what will happen.
Yeah, I agree. But I'm just looking at it in any way I possibly can. I'm looking into it too deep, I know, but I don't know. It's what I do. So I guess let's think of it this way. Let's reverse it just for fun because I know you really want to do it. If Ole Miss beats Auburn, gives Auburn their 2nd loss, and they win out and they beat Texas A&M, who's down a little bit, they beat Georgia, who at that point will probably be top 10 if they keep winning. They're 11 right now, and then they finish the season at Alabama, who's ranked 6, who could move up if they keep winning.
So you're saying Auburn beats Alabama?
I'm saying they win out even though they lose to Ole Miss. Their 2 losses would then be at the time ranked number 3 Mississippi State. Number 4, Ole Miss.
So they would have to beat Alabama, so that would give Alabama 2 losses. They would be probably done. Does Auburn play Mississippi? No, Mississippi State beat Auburn already, correct?
Yeah, but what I'm saying is if Auburn loses, that means Alabama, Auburn have 2 losses, as well as potentially Mississippi State.
I don't know, man.
Weird.
It's so hard. Like, it's just so hard to sit here and say what could happen.
Yeah.
Like, could you have 3 SEC West teams with 2 losses in the playoff? I don't see it happening, but
I don't either.
Maybe. Who knows?
Yeah.
Like, honestly, who knows?
Yeah.
With maybe the committee's just up the SEC's butts, and that's what it's going to be.
Well, who knows? We've seen 1 poll of theirs. You know what I'm saying? So it's we don't have an idea of what a team does 1 week of how it affects them. You know?
So, all right, well, who you got in the game? Who do you have winning?
I'm gonna go Auburn.
I got Ole Miss.
I don't think Bo Wallace is very good. Have you seen that dude throw?
No. I mean, I haven't really paid much attention. I honestly did not watch one football game last weekend.
I watched him play last weekend. Man, that dude has a noodle arm.
Yeah.
Like Matt Hasselbeck out there.
I just think Auburn going into Ole Miss. I think the biggest thing in the SEC is the home team. You know, it's so hard to win on the road in the SEC. It's and Ole Miss is going to be popping. They're going to be the Grove is going to be, I would love to go to the Grove one time and just tailgate. I don't even need to go to the game. That'd be that's my bucket list item, one of them. So, but I think the Ole Miss will be popping. Auburn's going to have a tough time. It's going to be tough. It's going to be a good game. I'm trying to watch that game, so definitely. Then we'll get to Notre Dame Navy. Obviously, you're going to pick Notre Dame, so give me your score.
I think Notre Dame, I want them to win big, so I'm going to go, I'm going to say they score 60. Much worse defense than North Carolina, who they almost did that to earlier. I'm going to go 61, and I'm going to say 10.
I said 45-10. So.
See, is that enough, though? Is that enough of a statement right there?
That's 35 points.
I guess we'll learn when that happens, right?
Right. No, I think 60 is a stretch, but hey, yeah.
I think they put up almost 50 twice this year.
True. No, I mean, stranger things have happened. I'm not saying it can't happen. So put you on the record for 60-10. I got 45-10.
That's only double our season average.
Only double. God. Oh, man. All right, well, let's wrap it up here. Any closing thoughts going into the Navy game on the playoff rankings? I know we've kind of hit a lot in a short amount of time.
You know, it's going to be interesting the way this all plays out, and obviously we're going to have more shows every week. You can catch us every Tuesday. We normally record about 9 o'clock at night. You can watch us live on our YouTube channel as we record, and if you can't watch us, go ahead and we have a Podbean account, which our Twitter account, which is @FromTheDome1842. We'll be tweeting out links. Please listen. We appreciate your guys' support. It's, you know, a couple things going into it. It's going to be interesting how this plays out. Notre Dame needs to take care of business. They need to win handily. They need to not give anybody any reason to sort of doubt the team that Notre Dame is. And I think they showed a lot last weekend against Florida State. I think that's going to give a lot of people, maybe help them give Notre Dame the benefit of the doubt. And I think that they're only going to hurt themselves if they don't really, really beat down Navy. And beat down bad teams coming down the stretch. I'm looking forward to another poll next week to kind of see, you know, if Notre Dame dominates, what that does to their ranking. How much does it help them? Or how much do they stay the same? I'm curious because we need a little bit more of a sample than we have right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's interesting. I want Notre Dame to win badly, and I want Notre Dame in the playoff. It's really that simple. And another thing that I wouldn't mind seeing addressed, or maybe I can do some research, or if anybody knows, please let me know. I'm really kind of curious to what the committee of 12 members does that puts their thoughts together and can kind of get a consensus top four. I'm curious to how that works out. I'm also kind of curious, like, I wonder how much time that people like Condoleezza Rice has to watch football games. I'm kind of curious, even guys like Pat Hayden, who's the athletic director at USC, I'm sure he's a pretty busy guy, and he does a lot with the football team, and he travels with the football team. I'm sure he probably works 60-hour weeks plus. You know, on Saturday, he's with the football team, like I just said. I'm curious to how many games he actually gets to watch. And you know, it's the same thing with a couple other members. Tyron Willingham's probably on the golf course all week. You just never know. What, you know, are these guys looking at box scores, I guess, is the point. Like, is that how we're kind of getting judged? It's just something I'm interested in and kind of curious in hearing. As always, Augie, love doing this with you. Thanks for, you know, we canceled last night so you can get an A on your test, and you did. Congratulations. You get all the credit in the world. Actually, I'll take all the credit in the world for canceling the show.
Yeah, okay.
But, yeah, let's hear your closing thoughts here.
Yeah, no, I absolutely agree. Notre Dame's got to go into FedEx Field and take care of business and not look back. Forget about Florida State. Forget about the rankings for a little bit and score some freaking points. Let's see an offensive show. Make me drink. That's all I'm going to say. So, I played the Notre Dame drinking game. I played by myself when we were all together at Florida State.
Yeah, because you only played by yourself because some of these rules you were making up were just absurd.
You finish your beer on a touchdown. Or no, you chug a beer on a touchdown. I'm sorry. You finish your beer on a first down. Or no, what was it? I can't remember.
You know, something like you got like 5 second pulls for every first down, which
is that's okay. Yes, yes, yes.
Which combined of the teams, there's like 60 to 70 those a game.
You only did it for Notre Dame.
Oh, whatever. Okay, so you're looking at 30 first downs. So you're looking at 35 second pulls. I think you said every time we ran the ball, we had to do some. We had to drink like 2 or 3 seconds.
It was just a drink.
Okay. Every time a white guy touched the ball, it was like finish your beer or something like that. It's just like it was absurd.
Yeah. Whatever.
I'm not down to drink, but good lord, I wanted to see the second half.
Well, I saw the second half. I just wasn't at the same stand I was the first half. So, all right. Well, yeah. Let's close this out. As always, as you said before, you can catch us on YouTube. You can catch us on Podbean. Follow us on Twitter at FromTheDome1842. Follow our personal accounts at Augie Farwig and at BraveBeatles34. We'll be back next Tuesday at 9 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. As always, I think that's all.
Yeah,
all right, let's close it out.
Hey, what do you got World Series tonight?
Oh, I'm rooting for the Royals. I'm ready to go watch that before my basketball game here. We're going to close this out. I'm going to turn on the TV. Got an intramural basketball game at 10, but hoping the Royals can make it a little... I want to see the Royals win because if the Cardinals aren't going to win, I don't want the Giants to win. So
I know you're a huge Cardinals fan. I mean, that's really tragic to hear that loss.
It's tough because it was a great kid and he was also the future of the organization. So
that's a tough
thing to happen for them.
It's another reminder of how short life is. And
yeah, that's right. Absolutely.
It's really unfair, to be honest. So.
Yep.
All right. Well, we're heading out. Thank you guys for listening. Appreciate the support as always. Augie, I'll see you soon. Go Irish.
Sounds good, man. Go Irish.